they've been able to work on any of the issues moving into week 5 of the LCS.
All right, picks and bans are up. We've got the Varus banned out and away, and a Rumble follows, targeted directly at Odoamne. See what we get for number 2 right now. If Giants stick to this top lane banning strategy, there are a lot of weapons on the H2K side.
Fascinating that Giants already shifting away from what is considered to be meta bans on the red side. Camille and Rengar still available. I wonder if Giants is going to take a similar strategy to Vitality, where they leave both open. H2K have a little bit of freedom, but the interesting thing about banning or leaving these power picks open on blue side somewhat forces forces blue side to go for these early bans, because they feel like, we don't want to risk leaving too many power picks open, so let's take them away.
Yeah, the mind games for Giants already working. They ban another top laner. It's this Shen that has been proving quite tenacious, hard to deal with in those protection compositions. Let's see if H2K are going to be forced once again into banning something a little bit more meta, or at least a little bit more top tier bannable.
Now, if you are H2K, we have to remember that there's been a shift in terms of jungle priority. AD carry tends to be the primary focus. Yesterday, we actually saw a lot of prioritization on Graves for Trick. Mm-hmm. Now, Jankos tends to be more on the aggressive side. Someone like Lee Sin has also been rearing his face. Whether or not either team wants to look to prioritize junglers has shifted. Now, champions like Jhin are available. Malzahar is still pretty potent in the meta. Tahm Kench is someone that's made a lot of value and contributions, especially when we look at yesterday's games. But H2K actually have a lot of freedom right now in what they want to try and prioritize.
Yeah, we'll see what that first pick comes through. Probably give the man a lot of credit. He gives the team a lot of direction, and they've had a lot of success as a result of it. So the LeBlanc could be the choice, and it is locked in for Febiven to start things off. Back to Giants.
So Febiven used to be very, very well known for his LeBlanc back in, 2015 Febiven, the year of Febiven.
Yeah, not just that, he had the Xerath and things too.
He did, very much so. But the fact that H2K have picked this up already suggests that they're looking for a lot of early game power in the mid lane. Giants in response, they could go for a Kha'Zix. Jhin makes a lot of sense too, given that he is the next best AD carry available on the list. I wonder how much Giants actually value the Tahm Kench. We heard on the desk that Zyra is something that Huston really values, but with that not really quite being meta right now, they could look to go for something like an early Malzahar if they wanted to.
I was going to say, Malzahar kind of the other side of that equation, because even though he also was hit with the nerf bat, he's been seeing a little bit more pickup in Europe this week, or at least still being prioritized. Do Giants make that choice and round out their bottom lane in the last couple of seconds? It's ticking down right now. Lozark whispering to the ears of the team, and Inno is going to be the Ryze for Knight.
Now, earlier on in the day, we did see the Ryze being picked up into the LeBlanc as an answer to it. Not only is it fairly difficult for the LeBlanc to really get a hard snowball into a Ryze, but also he'll naturally outscale her should she not get an early lead in the 1-3-1.
Yeah, so it's looking good for Giants.
It's really it's a good pick, and it also fits Knight's playstyle.
Absolutely. The Lee Sin is locked in instantly for H2K, by the way, so Jankos is definitely looking to grab that early aggression. If they can snowball between the LeBlanc and the Lee, they might be able to shut down that Ryze early on, but we need to see more to round this composition out. It's the Maokai, so they've gone for the top half of the map so far.
Interesting that we see a big tank, a teamfighting tank in the top lane from H2K. A lot of value on it early on as well, because this is actually going to give Giants some freedom in terms of counterpicking. Champions like Kennen are still available that have been used as an answer. We saw actually Swain bans coming out from G2 yesterday, also a possible point of contention. But I think it's a little bit risky from H2K to pick that early on, but it does also imply that they want to make sure that they can get a strong bottom lane duo for Nuclear and Che.
Yeah, interesting to see if that's because maybe H2K are not necessarily thinking Giants can outplay them and they can take themselves bad matchups. We'll have to find out if it works out for them anyways. There's a quick lock-in of the Graves on Giants' side, so Memento will be picking him up, and we enter the second phase of bans.
Now, if you're Giants, you want to try and pinch some of the AD carries that have been left available. You could look to ban away Sivir. She's a very potent team-fighting AD carry, scales very nicely,
like
good
insurance
during the laning phase too, and it synergizes nice if you are going towards more team-fighting with the Maokai. One possible option, there's also the Ashe available, significantly reduced in terms of priority since the lethality changes.
But yeah, we're on the bottom of the priority now.
We are indeed. So Giants right now, focusing a bit more on the supports rather than on AD carries, suggests that they may be looking for an early Malzahar rotation.
Man, a top ban by H2K. They get rid of the Trundle right now to try and give Odoamne a better matchup. Back to Giants. If they ban another support away, we'll see. If not, at AD carry, we'd be looking to See if they take the Sivir away.
Karma's a possibility too. Yeah. Very potent in the meta right now, especially as we've seen the fall-off. I say fall-off, just the moving away of being Malzahar, being the top tier supports right now. Well, there we are. It looks like AD carry focus is the round out for Giants.
Taking their time about it though too. Giants have not really been in any rush to finish up this pick and ban phase for sure. We'll see if the last ban's going to be coming through for H2K. They similarly are taking their time about it right now.
Now, I think that if you are Giants, you look to get yourself the Malzahar on this rotation. H2K will likely respond with a Sivir Karma. The alternative is Giants could look to take the Karma away, and you actually force H2K to really dig pretty deep into their support pool. Champions like Nami become then the next best that they could potentially go for.
It's a little curious that they decided on H2K side to ban out two top lanes. Flaxish locks and the Alawi, that could be an even more interesting thing to discuss. But Oduwamne always has been this kind of player who is happy to take matchups where he doesn't necessarily win out. So I'm concerned that they're deciding that they need to ban these things out after the fact. Still Giants playing with it for the last couple of seconds. They grab themselves the Zyra. So even though it was lower on the priority with supports banned away, there it goes.
Now, for those who may be unaware, the big change to Zyra was that once you use your Q on your plants or your E on your plants, the plants now just hit the target closest to them rather than the nearest champion, which means that harassing with the plants is not as reliable as it was before, which is why a lot of teams have put it lower down on the priority. But Hustlin is saying he's still confident on the champion, and he's still looking to make use of the strengths that she does have.
Yep, they can combo up pretty well between the Jhin and the Zyra down in the bottom lane, but H2K looking to give him a hard time here. Nuclear locks in the Sivir for himself, and the Karma, as was available. Pretty classic power bot lane if it gets locked in.
Very potent at pushing. H2K will definitely have the priority down in the bottom lane simply because the wave clear from Sivir and Karma is much more than a Jhin will be able to handle. Now Giants to round things out, you did see the Alawi hover. I think that it would work nicely in the composition that they have because you set it for a nice 1-3-1. It will be incredibly oppressive against a Maokai, and we've even seen Flaxish bring it out earlier on in the split where he demonstrated that he knows the limitations of that champion.
Well, all that's left to decide is if they're going to take it into the top lane up against Oduwamne's Maokai. The last seconds tick down, they lock the Gragas instead. It's a little bit more damage maybe up front, but I don't know about that one.
He's a tanky engage that can exert a lot of pressure during in the top lane, but it also is a great way for Giants to be able to force fights. Remember that one of the big things that knocked Gragas out of the meta was the hits that he took to his ultimate in particular, where now there's the channel time of the travel as the ultimate comes out is now fixed, which means that it becomes very easy to predict and play around. And that was a large reason as to why people wanted to move away from it.
Yeah.
But he has recently seen a slight resurgence. He has been played over in the NALCS as well as in the LCK. But we'll now see it here for the first time in Europe.
And specifically into this matchup too, people are playing it into the Maokai. I mean, the last time we saw it was Ixu. So we'll see what they decide to bring out here or how they decide to bring it out here. Flax has clearly been watching VODs from around the world. They're probably taking his headphones off there as the two coaches will shake hands to walk off stage. See if the bag of tricks was on the Giant side this time around. Well, curious, Fetty. Who do you think has this one in the draft? Just taking the name tags off the teams.
I think H2K have to do a little more in the early game simply because they have the LeBlanc. And after her early hits, I think that it will be slightly harder to get a snowball against Ryze. When you look at the composition from Giants, good scaling. They transition nicely into a 1-3-1, but they cannot afford to fall into any early deficits, especially to the Lee Sin from Jankos.
Yeah, that's going to be the dangerous one. H2K, if you think they're going to be able to take this one without breaking a sweat, don't forget to hop on Twitter, tweet at LOL Esports, hashtag H2KWin. But the Giants are going to be hungry for one here. And you guys know what to do, hashtag GIAWin if you think they can take it. It is going to be the best of three. Long time to go if Giants want to keep this one close. We'll see as they leave it out on the Rift. We load up into game, and here we go.
So now, if you are Giants, your main focus should be on investing in early vision. Because what you're going to see a lot of from Jankos is prioritization on snowballing this LeBlanc, taking advantage of the fact that H2K have a pushing bottom lane. The top lane is likely going to be ignored.
It's hard to ignore that from Oduwamne.
It is a little
though.
Bit hard to ignore that.
Yeah, it is. I don't know if it's more annoying or adorable.
It's pretty cute. I mean, look at
that's really cute, too. I mean, what we have here is two big guys dressed up in very, very funny costumes.
Yes.
I don't know if we can really ignore that.
Well, we won't, but I know that Jankos is likely to. He needs to be careful of the potential collapse.
I get baited up, and he gets stopped up for a second, has to safeguard it out. Giant's trying to make those moves early on. He's going to be low on health, might have to back here.
Jankos now having to start with his W, will hurt his clear speed a little bit. Even being forced to use one of the stacks on his potion, on his pot. Refillable, even.
Mm-hmm. Pots have stacks.
Yes, they do. Now, Jankos, fortunately, he is playing Lee Sin, so it won't hurt him dramatically in the early game. Ooh, interesting. So Memento actually starting on the Raptors. Very creative path. This isn't something that we usually see. Usually you do start on the buffs. Memento going to be able to get a very early level too, but with his clear and with his ability to kite, he can afford to do this. He's just going to transition up to the reds, and I wonder if he might go for an early invade onto Jankos.
Could do. We'll have to keep an eye on those junglers, but let's check in on the bottom side for now. Actually, wait, hold on a second, because Jankos is already up in mid. Knight's going to be forced to flash immediately. Just when we want to talk about the bot lane, they got to keep bringing it back mid.
Level 2 gank from Jankos in the mid lane. We have not seen that in a while.
It's a good thing that Knight had himself a Courage of the Colossus. He wasn't really going to be able to pop it at level 1, but still, if he gets ganked like that again, he'll probably be relying on it.
We haven't seen Courage of the Colossus on a rise for a while. It was there at the very start of the season on 7.1. But now we see a bit of aggression up in top lane.
We'll see, and back to the mid. Tevin trying to trade out with Knight. LeBlanc definitely needs to get ahead in this matchup, otherwise the Ryze is going to have quite a lot to say about that. But yeah, Flagship's just kind of making this top lane a little bit more interesting than it might be otherwise. Odawamne might have his work cut out for him, and man, Febivin is forced to flash away. Knight, nice, just playing with him there.
Knight taking advantage of the earlier level 3. He has his full combo available. Febivin oversteps ever so slightly, and then Knight is quickly able to punish, so now he's gained a little bit more lane control. He's going to be able to get the push, force Febivin to back early. But we do have to note that Febivin actually picking up the teleport. So you can clearly tell that he's playing towards that 1-3-1 a little bit later on into the game. The fact that we're already seeing so much investment from Jankos in the mid lane, though, demonstrates that his priority is just trying to get Febivin ahead, and already he's back in the mid.
Yeah, it's what we talked about earlier on. Let's see, without a flash this time and not a whole lot of mana, Febivin was playing the bait game. Knight's going to get dodged out. Oh my goodness, Memento is tagged in to join the party. Picks up first, picks up second. Is he going to live? I think so.
So Memento with a very quick double kill right at the start of the game. You couldn't really have asked for a better start, especially against the Lee Sin and the LeBlanc. Remember, what we talked about was Giants had to be so aware of this early snowball from the H2K mid and jungle duo, and they've been able to stymie it right from the get-go.
Yeah, maybe now H2K have to worry about the snowball from Graves. I mean, we saw in the hands of Trick on G2, when a Graves can get ahead early and start scaling up faster than expected, he can really do a lot of work. And Memento, he's shooting for it right now. We'll see what he's able to get done elsewise on the map. Let's head back down to bot lane, though, where it's been a much quieter affair. Nuclear keeping pace with HeQ in this duo lane.
Yeah, we talked a little bit about early on during the draft where you are naturally going to get pushed in a lot if you are Giants, because going up against the Sivir and Akama will just result in a constant pushing power in the bottom lane, which unfortunately for Azira and a Jhin, more specifically for the Jhin, he can't really deal with that push. So for the time being, HeQ and Huslin will be put on the back foot. But when you're the Giants, 4.5 minutes into this game, you must be pretty pleased with what you've been able to pick up so far.
Yeah, it's 1,000K, or it's 1,000K, geez, wow, that'd be a lot of gold. 1,000 gold ahead right now, so Giants aren't having too bad of a time, and unfortunately we've got a pause on the screen. Maybe they're just like surprised that they're ahead this much.
Oh, maybe. I have already a double longsword. I think there's some kind of bug on my screen, but
this doesn't happen in scrims.
This doesn't happen, no. No, obviously joking around with Giants, they have been able to get early leads in the past. Their game ones have actually gone a lot in their favor very early on in the split, where they were able to, the big one that stands out to me was their game against Fnatic, where Memento was able to have a big impact early on. They were winning a lot of their lanes individually, and they were able to get that surprise upset against Fnatic. So it's not utterly shock factor, right, for Giants to be able
That's
to
true.
Get these early leads, and you have to respect that It was a good response from Memento to be in the right place at the right time. He moved in towards the enemy jungle. He took away the raptor camps from Jankos, and it just so happened to be that as he was making his rotation back, a gank came in from Jankos towards the middle lane, and because Memento there came a little bit later, he had all of his abilities up, so it was much easier for him to be able to turn that gank around.
Yeah, sometimes it is about being in the right place at the right time, but Memento definitely has some good game sense there, and I think you can really see that he knows that Jankos is going to try to camp mid because he's already done it. He's already done it once. He's already gone there twice. And that seems like the obvious game plan. So knowing it, he comes in, he makes the big play, and he comes up huge. He gets himself two kills right off the bat. And, I mean, this, if anything, this is the biggest strength that Giants have is in Memento right now. We've seen some good things out of this young jungler. And you're going up against Jankos, you're going to need to be bringing your A game.
You really will. So we want to have a back. We haven't. We want to have a look.
We haven't
back.
Led either.
We want to have a look back at how this first blood actually set up for the side of Giants. And as we prep that, we have to remember, like, as a team like Giants, one of the big criticisms that they have had is their communication within the team, right? Because even with the early leads that they've been able to ascertain in the past, they haven't necessarily been able to translate that into anything because they don't really set up very effectively around these objectives. They don't properly use the advantages that they have been able to get. So now that they've been able to get a 1,000 gold lead at 4.5 minutes into the game, communication is something that I really want to keep my eyes on. How well are the laners in the jungle, or how well are the laners communicating with the jungler? This guy's overextending. We can use this as an opportunity to get some vision in. How can we set up for the next dragon that's on the map right now?
And that's in the early game as well. Once we get into the later stages of the game, assuming things keep relatively even, I think the big thing to really watch is how they're going to be able to set up for the bigger objectives, the Barons. How are they going to force fights off against a team like H2K, who we can honestly criticize a bit of their communication too. We talked about last week's struggles against G2.
Yeah, well, H2K, one of their problems has always been a bit of an overcommitment, overextension. And in the first blood, it wasn't their fault. The play itself was promising. But what else is promising is that we're getting back into game, ladies and gentlemen.
You promised me, so I know you're going to deliver, Vetti. It looks like the players are all ready, so we're going to hop back into the game. And once again, we're only shy of 5 minutes right now, but Giants are sitting pretty. They've got themselves two kills. Crowd elated that we're back into the game. No more pause screen for now. HeQ, low on mana. He's got that final shot looking to send it nuclear Che's way. He's just going to use it on a minion instead. Keeping farm, but as you said, going to be pushed back for a little while until they can get those later levels.
Look at Knight already playing aggressively against Febivant after he's been able to pick up his tier, as well as getting himself a bit of magic resistance. So the laning phase that was likely or needed to snowball for H2K is now going heavily in the favor of Knight.
He's definitely having a good time. And Ryze is something that, you know, he kind of became known for a little bit more towards the end of last split. Let's take a look, though, at this play once again that netted the double first blood.
So again, I want to iterate that this gank from Jankos is not bad because he knows that there's no flash on top of Knight. It's going to be difficult for him to escape, and with the early game damage of both Febivant and Jankos, that should be more than enough. But the fact that Memento was just in the right place at the right time, able to come out from this angle and just get all this damage off, just resulted in him getting a clean and easy double kill.
Yeah, I think Jankos hitting that Sonic Wave might have made that one a little bit different, to be honest, but you got to be able to cleanly execute 100% of the time. We're at level 4 in the bottom lane. We're at level 5 up in the top. 6 now is Flaxus. She's gone up ahead. Let's check back in down here. As I said, it's been a quiet affair, but HeQ is still hanging on.
Now this bottom lane, as we mentioned, for H2K, were actually pretty successful last week against G2. They were able to get a number of kills. And while you could criticize the bottom lane of G2 for their misplays, you still have to respect the fact that H2K have grown a lot in how they effectively use their bottom lane. We look at the CSD at 10, while they may not be the most dominant in terms of laners, they're very good at getting gold leads because of what their team is doing on the rest of the map.
Yeah, they're getting a lot of objectives. Speaking of on the rest of the map, Knight finds himself a little bit caught up, and Jankos is right there at his back. That Courage of the Colossus shield coming in handy.
So Knight forced to use the cleanse once again. But we are seeing a lot of pressure being exerted from H2K, not only in the bottom, but also in the mid. Jankos, even after his early deficit, doing what he can to try and claw back something for Febivant to work with. But just look at the level difference between the two junglers right now.
And the farm, I mean, that's double at this point. So he's having a ball right now, Memento is. And up in the top lane, Flax is just still finding it not too hard to deal with Otawamne. So Giants, I mean, if they've got 2 out of 3 winning lanes, despite the tent that Jankos has pitched in the mid lane, I think they're doing all right. Che's caught up now, and whoa, that's a lot of damage. The Zyra plants are still able to get some stun and some damage off there. he's going to have to be careful as he oversteps himself.
Now, I find it fascinating that the Giants have actually invested a lot of their vision around the top half of the map. I think the main priority for Memento is making sure that Jankos is being dissuaded from trying to gank the middle lane. Because if you control that much of the river, then the only avenue that Jankos has to gank is through the bottom river. And the fact that those are control wards now means that Memento can prioritize getting that Scuttle Crab, using his trinket, and the fact that he's gone for an early tracker's life to just maintain vision control and enable Knight to just continue scaling through the laning phase.
Yes, indeed. This is a great start for Giants, one we haven't seen too much, but let's see if they can keep this one up. But it is a fake LeBlanc coming down to the bottom side, and he baits the heal. Oh, that was worth.
I like that play. Really creative from Febiven, using the ultimate that both the Giants' bottom lane fell for.
A little squeamish there. Not the face, not the face.
You've got to feel so bad, though, after using the heal, because you're just like, "Duh, I was baited. No." But it's easy to feel tricked, because on the spectator client, sure, it's easy for us to tell, but in-game, you really can't. It's very difficult to notice the difference.
Yeah, especially with the mobility LeBlanc offers. I mean, it makes that new kit really that much more hard to tell what's going on. And that's the whole point of LeBlanc, in all honesty. But let's take a look back at the vision game. You talked about the investment in mid and up in the river for Giants, but they've shifted it down into the jungle. And look at what Memento's doing. Just waiting, seeing if he can get a catch off on Jankos.
Notice that the dragon is available for them to take. The bottom lane needs to still back for H2K, and given that Ryze has already got push priority in mid, they can actually set up for a potential dragon play. Given the clear speed of Graves, he may very well be able to solo it. He just has to be careful of the possible collapse, which when you look at the lanes right now, he's actually in a good position to do so.
Yeah. Both dual laners have actually yet to back, but that's about to change. EQ and Hustlin will be going, and unfortunately for Jankos, he's coming a little bit late. Oh, they've stopped it, actually, so maybe not. Seems thinking to catch out. Nuclear trying to make himself look tasty on the hunt. Is popped. In comes Jankos. Tagging in. It's a 2v3, and they're going to look to equalize. Che a little bit low. Memento gets the blowback, but it's Jankos that's going to find the kill onto Hustlin. Che manages to get out with his life. Flashes, heals, everything burned right now, but Memento is not done. Another flash, and now a teleport. That'll dissuade Memento for now.
Memento still has his ultimate. Not going to use it to get a possible collapse down onto Che, but the fact that H2K were able to get themselves something back is always promising for the lineup, especially when they rely so much on an early advantage.
Memento looking to chase down Jankos, not happening. But yeah, gold advantage still Giants' way, but it's not huge. It's only 10 minutes into this game, and you know, not a super crucial dragon to try and contest down in the bottom lane, so H2K are actually going to be able to back off in the mid. Knight's still pushing waves here into Febiven, but it's very even on the farm game, so that gold really is only coming from the kill differential. Maybe the difference in jungle farm as well.
The thing is, if you're Giants at this point, you're still fine, right? Because you have a good scaling composition, your mid laner is doing well against his lane counterpart, the Gragas is going very even against the Maokai, so you're still setting up nicely for your 1-3-1. The priority is just that you don't fall behind this LeBlanc, because Febiven really is the determining factor in this game. And he
Speaking
may be
of,
looking for a pickup in the top lane.
Flax just has got to watch himself. Oh, that's a big hitbox. Febiven's eyeballing it. Ah, he's not going.
Febiven did get spotted out on that Tri-Brush ward, which immediately dissuaded Flaxus from walking into the river.
He's trying to be healthy, man. He has some fruit instead of going for the fat man.
Yep.
All right, back into mid. They'll still keep farming away, but H2K are poking and prodding around to see if they can find themselves any kills. Trying to get Febiven ahead right now on this LeBlanc. Risky to do. Giants playing it the safe way, grinding it out for 11 minutes here, but they still have that kill advantage all on Memento's side, who feels confident enough to go into the enemy jungle. You know Jankos is around. It looks like Flax just might be the one who's caught, though. See if he can get out of this one right now. Here comes Jankos. He's walking real slow, but he pulls the big barrel to dissuade the gank. Meanwhile, down on the bottom side, Hustlin gets taken pretty low, and there's no recourse, but it's all a bait because they're waiting for Knight to come around in. Che and Nuclear are not falling for it.
You can see Knight and Memento setting up for a possible die.
Oh, there's the curtain call. Okay, on four, on two, the tower will not save them for long. Hustlin stepping a little far forward, but he gets the Strangle Thorns off, and now Knight is going to get the kill. It looks like another's going Hikyu's way. Quick one and two, but Hustlin nearly bought it in the process.
Giants with a very well-executed dive. They realized that Febiven had tried to go for a roam early on. They knew that Jankos was in the top side of the map, and Giants took the opportunity to get themselves a couple kills down in the bottom lane, extending that gold lead fairly significantly.
And Flaxus didn't die in the earlier attempt. He was able to get out of harm's way, and now he's back up to the top side, farming away pretty easily against Sotawamne. So really, H2K have been foiled at a lot of attempts to get themselves early ahead in this game, And it's rare we see Jankos kind of playing second fiddle to a jungler.
He really has. Nothing but respect for Memento is using the Blast Cone, something that we've been seeing throughout the LCS since their introduction, to completely avoid that Tri-Brush ward. H2K realized too little too late that the play is coming. And it was just a great setup from Giants because Knight had already pushed in the mid lane. There was no time for the LeBlanc to respond. Jankos had to go back to base. So the setup from Giants was completely clean. There was no risk. But speaking of risk, look at Flaxish.
Okay, let's see if he gets out of this one. Shay just appeared right up top and Nuclear there as a follow. Boomerang Blade coming in. Flaxish a little low. I don't see him getting out of this one, and Jankos just kicks him in the face. They're going to try to trade this quick tower. Let's see if Giants can answer back fast enough. But H2K got one kill, and they are looking to polish this one down. First blood, or first tower blood, I should say, does get taken in their favor.
H2K realize that they're eventually going to lose the tower in the bottom lane. So they think, let's try and get something while we still can. They make the map movement up to top, and they set up a very clean dive onto Flaxish. He still had his flash because he realized that once Jankos had arrived, there was nothing that he could do. Yeah. So the best option for Giants right now is to just try and return with a dragon so that in terms of objectives, they get the net gain.
No reason for Flaxish to flash. He might have failed. We're down on dragon, so Giants, despite the fact that they gave up tower first blood, they still were able to get a tower themselves and secure a dragon, and they're still in the gold lead right now. It's still about 600, 700, so it hasn't shifted too much, and Knight's able to get back on mid with the help of Hustlin to clear these minions away.
What we have to remember is, again, this LeBlanc. How is the LeBlanc doing, right? Level 10 has completed a very early Abyssal Scepter, not typically what you would go for when you're trying to get an early snowballing LeBlanc, but you have to because of how strong the Ryze is going to become. He's built so much magic resistance for himself that it is too difficult for Febiven to be able to get any kind of snowball, so now he has to build for the 1v1 that he's going to get forced into now that the map has opened up.
Yeah, it's nice. Giants can just force to say, hey, we are going to play this later game and you're going to have to try and match us. Now the Rod of Ages has just been finished for Knight, still stacking up his tier, but he's not in too much danger. And you can see him, even though he gets chunked occasionally, getting away from the attempts by Febiven to make the big plays. Now, Febiven himself might get caught up, and he dodges, but there's a flash, a blowback, and Febiven will walk away. Little hyphy there from Giants. Memento's going to walk away empty-handed.
Wow. Very aggressive flash from Memento. Bit of a missed route from Hustlin is what prevented Memento from really being able to get all that burst damage down.
It was a pixel away, though.
He really did have a lot of damage ready in the bank, though, because notice that having completed that Serrated Dirk on top of his jungle item, he was ready to get the collapse. But they weren't able to get the kill. You end up losing your flash, so it doesn't mean a huge amount for the side of Giants. It just means that they're going to return back to what they were doing, which is farming, start to set up for this 1-3-1, and just play out, because they know they have the stronger later game.
Yeah, still playing a controlled style right now. Jankos is going to get caught up for just a second. The Deadly Flourish, the plant's doing a little bit of damage to him, but Shay's got his back. It'll be a while before we see these AD carries really getting up to speed because the items they're not quite at yet. But here's a big thing for Giants. The fact that these guys have the most isolated deaths in the LCS, and they've only given up one, I believe, in this game so far. That's just the Gragas up top, and it's kind of a sacrifice, to be honest.
Just for some context, isolated deaths is when you die alone, regardless of how many people there are. So
nobody wants to do that.
As you rightly said, Pyra, the instance of Flaxish dying up top would be an example of an isolated death. But the fact that Giants have so many demonstrates that it's not just Flaxish getting collapsed upon, right? It's not just him that is getting caught out of position. It's the entire team. We saw it early on in the split from players like Knight in particular overextending in the bottom lane. And so far, what we're seeing is a little bit more awareness from Giants, not willing to make those same sort of risks. But as I say that night, he needs to be careful of this trap in the brush.
Yeah, it's one of those caster curse things, the moment it could happen. We'll see. It's like a standoff in the brush. But I don't think Knight's going to win that one. 2v1, and Febiven comes in, kicks him back, but Memento has tagged his way in. The chains are on. They get one kill. Can they get another? Knight's going to shield. The reverse bait, and a double kill for Memento.
Great response from Giants. Memento once again being the savior for his mid laner, immediately there to just bring out the damage and turn it around once again, 2-0.
That was the ballsiest bait that I've seen in a while. Knight should have been dead, but that shield saved his life.
Courage of the Colossus, man.
Yeah, that's
the
what you do.
The more members that there are, the bigger the shield.
All right. So they're going to be able to take down tower too. Giants are looking pretty happy about this right now. The wave is going to get melted a little bit by Che, but they have another one on top. Odoamne is going to try to teleport in. Can Flaxish interrupt? He's a second too late. And now they got a party portal out of there. See if they can still make their escape. Teleports are flying. They want to make this a party in the bot lane. Memento is going to get shut down by Febiven before it all even begins in earnest. Curtain Call's opened up, but Hikyu, will it be enough? Febiven's getting bopped left, right, and center, and Knight takes him down. Odo's going to get hustling. It is a brawl down bottom lane, but Dust clears and ends up being a 2-for-1.
H2K using their double teleports to force the fight down in the bottom lane means that they should be able to go for a
dive. They're not done yet! Oh! Whoa, whoa, whoa! Knight! Good night.
Not respecting the possible collapse from Jankos onto the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. He ends up face checking a brush, and Knight ends up giving away his life. So Giants now losing a little bit more control over the map.
What is Flax just doing right here? I don't know about this one. He's going to get kicked once again under tower. That's not going to save him for very long. He's trying to get something, but the aggro juggle on the tower is just too much. So Jankos claims a kill for himself. They'll get this tower, and H2K, they're going to get the gold lead.
H2K are climbing their way back in. Giants just overextends a little bit too long in the bottom. You can see the portal from Knight is promising. It buys him a little bit of time for allow Hustlin to come in. But then Hikyu on the backside, he really can't contribute much to the fight. And the fact that Giants are in such a deficit means that they can't really turn things around. Good ultimate from Flaxish to be able to get a return kill on the side of Giants. But this is where you make a bit of a mistake if you're Knight. He wanted to either get a bit of vision down, drop a ward onto the buff. He was even going to go back to base, and then he walks straight into the warm embrace of Jankos. So they can then quickly transition this into a tier 1 tower and reclaim control over the map.
Yeah, this is where Flax just commits the cardinal sin of League of Legends, dying. But he does it when there's really no hope to save this tower. I don't know if he expected there to be a lot of people there, but it just kind of looked unnecessary. So he gives his life once again, the tower goes down. And H2K, now they come out ahead. Pretty well so far.
Memento
does get Jankos. I missed that part the first time around.
I too did miss that. You can just see the response from Jankos is, damage.
I was wondering why the gold was a little more even than that. Okay, so Memento is having a ball this game. 5-1-3. He's got himself quite a lot of pen going on. And they're going to need it if they want to win this fight over the dragon. The Infernal has just spawned. Baron's about to come up pretty soon, so we start seeing the objective trades get more and more costly. Jankos tries to go in, and somehow Flax is just able to sidestep it away, but the triple kick is on. Hustlin's got to be careful. He has not got a big health bar. Is that Zyra?
Now, while H2K don't force a successful fight here, they get a lot of chip damage down onto the bottom lane of Giants. This will enable H2K to now transition over to the dragon, and they will be in a better position to set up vision control and force the play from happening. What they have to be careful of is not overstaying and overcommitting, because you can already see Hustlin making his way back towards the fight.
Jankos is going to start soloing this right now. Giants can sniff this out. They should be able to stop it, but you know they have the scuttle vision. It's just outside. I don't know if they know this is going down, so Jankos might get the cheeky steal or the cheeky sneak off, and it's gone down.
I like the play from H2K. Just steal it from underneath Giants' nose. They couldn't quite get the deep vision down to spot the play from happening. And H2K were able to get themselves a clean objective.
Yeah, smart focus. Able to sneak it despite the Scuttlecrab vision, and now Giants, they might be the ones scrambling themselves. That 8% AD and AP is gonna work wonders for H2K as they try to overcome what's going to be this late game rise, what's already this powerful, powerful Graves. Flax is looking for a pickoff onto Febiven with the help of Memento, but it ain't happening. Not right now anyway, so instead they gotta settle for blue buff.
Now Giants, they wanted to look to try and take that tier one in the top lane, but because they didn't quite have the proper minion wave, they didn't quite have the proper vision, they aren't able to take it, which means that H2K can start pushing up in the mid lane. And this is where you start to see H2K's composition start to come to be, because they too have a 1-3-1. We talked a lot about how this setup relies a lot on the LeBlanc being able to duel the Ryze, because if she can't, then Ryze is going to have constant pressure. The way in which you can compensate for this is using Jankos is actually a roaming death possibility, right? Because with a Sivir and a Karma in the mid lane, you don't actually need more wave clear. You don't need more presence. They have more than enough disengage, more than enough tools to stymie any push from Giants, which actually gives a lot of freedom to Jankos, with which you think that it might be a 1v1, but it can actually end up being a 2v1.
Yes, it can. Giants were looking to make something versus something for themselves, but poor Jankos. I think his build really kind of spells out what he is trying to do, trying to be that roaming death machine. As you said, he's got the Edge of Night completed, which is not something we see on Lee Sin's all the time.
I also think the Edge of Night is just a really good item in general. It gives you a lot of valuable magic
resistance. When like three or four different roles are building it, it's a little broken in all honesty. But Giants are going to be able to knock down a turret. They had enough push to do it. But the gold game is just so close right now. And with Dragon Split, the more valuable one going H2K's way, I mean, it's looking okay for them at the moment.
Good map movement from Giants, punishing the fact that both Jankos and Febiven were topside. This is the risk that you have when you do use this roaming jungle style to try and turn the 1v1 into 2v1s, which is basically that if Giants get more members mid, then you have time to respond. You're quickly able to force these objectives, and that enabled Giants to get that tier 1 in the mid.
So they grabbed it. Still, I think for Giants, they want to wait for that late game, as you said. They want to get themselves into a position where they can overwhelm and fight. And it is going to be about this Baron control for several minutes to come.
You can see a lot of wards invested from H2K already around the Baron pit. 23 minutes. Their Baron take speed is not the greatest, but nevertheless, it is something that they want to make sure they have control over. They haven't put much deep vision in yet, but now that you can see the LeBlanc pushing up top, Civit pushing up mid, this will enable H2K to start pressing their vision line ever so slightly further onto the turf of Giants.
Make it harder for Giants to try and contest when the Baron becomes the possibility. There will be a Mountain Drake as well, so Giants may be wanting to focus towards the bottom side of the map right now. Let's see where they place their wards, but Jankos still looking to even some odds whenever it comes about. They've got Flaxish on bot side. They've got Knight on the top, the 1-3-1 from Giants for the time being. See if they have enough damage. Seraph's just finished, just upgraded for Knight. He's going to get scarier and scarier as this game goes on. Memento's already scary. Jankos doesn't want any of that.
But if you're Giants, you can see them actually struggle a little bit right now to know what to do. Because yes, they have a 1-3-1, but their vision control is preventing them from being able to properly set up for it and gain any kind of control over the map. Because with Mountain Drake next on the board, that could be an objective that they look to try and play around. But with the Baron so readily available, they always have to make sure that they still are not giving too much pressure on that side of the map.
This is the problem the Giants have had, you know, the entire split. It seems like they have a little bit of, you know, good calling in the early game. They're able to get some advantages for themselves, but the team seems fairly inexperienced when it comes to later game objective control, later game objective calling. They just haven't been playing all together. That contributes to things like those isolated deaths when they just find themselves completely caught out and don't know what to do.
Fortunately, if you're on Giants, you do have the Ryze, who's going to be a very potent split pusher. But look at H2K trying to set something up right now.
The bait! It was all about the minions. Flaxus, he's going to get himself caught up, and there's nowhere for him to go. The chains were landing, and Febiven gets himself his second kill of the game. But Jankos might follow. HQ with a big crit in the mid.
Both teams forcing plays both in the mid and the bottom lane, getting themselves a pick. But what does it mean for H2K? Because they've got a minion lane, a minion wave in the bottom lane. They have two members, and they could start to look to put some pressure on that tier two.
But the curtain call is going to be opened up, and now Nuclear and Che are going to have to run out of the range of it to try and clear this minion wave. Fortunately, they've got the Sivir that can do it, and there's a teleport on the backside. Stranglethorn's up. Che's going to flash away from it, and Giants have just bailed out of this situation. They're bringing Ryze to the party, but H2K's bringing Febiven's LeBlanc, and it is going to be stopped where it stands.
A swift response from H2K to stymie the push of Giants. Giants won't walk away empty-handed, though. But H2K should very well be able to return this. So good map movements from both teams, realizing that, hey, we're Giants, we have a minion wave top, let's get that tower. H2K realize, oh, there's no one to stop us, let's quickly push mid. But with the dragon spawning in 30 seconds, this will be a better opportunity for H2K because they can drop a couple wards down as they look to back. They won't be able to contest any of the vision, but that doesn't matter. When you're able to get yourself a pick like this, this is the sort of thing that H2K want to do. Get a couple more kills onto your LeBlanc. Make her that potent split pusher and punish the overextension of Giants. Speaking of overextensions, Jankos, for some reason, was very extended up in the mid lane. He had no tower of safety. He had a lot of vision control around the top half of the map, but he ends up getting caught out, and they nearly lost the tier 2 in the mid. But swift response, as we were talking about from H2K, prevents that from happening.
Speaking of swift response, Giants are able to pick themselves up a Mountain Drake. Before Jankos can even really get around the side of it, they'd already chased Febiven away from the pit. So they pick themselves up that extra objective control. But once again, Flaxus is going to be caught. This time, he's got Memento at his back. So Giants trying to rove together, keep themselves nice and safe as we get close to that 27-minute mark on the map. Checking in. Knight is playing a real safe game here. That third item Guardian Angel, he is going to be real hard to take down.
I mean, he's got his core. The Rod of Ages and the Archangel Staff being completed means that Ryze will hurt. So his priority now is just to survive as long as possible. And bear in mind, when you have a fed Graves, and you also have a Jhin, who's gone for the Infinity Edge plus Ghostblade combo, that's just a lot of damage. It's more of a throwback to the old Jhin build that we used to see, which was investing a little bit more in crit, so you have more teamfight value.
I might have got him Jankos on that one.
It also makes him a little bit more effective against tanks, too, because you just have a little bit more damage, likely working towards a rapid-fire cannon and a Last Whisper, as we see an engage.
There goes the curtain call. The party portal's only bringing Knight right now, but he flashes forward. It's going to be followed through by Nuclear. H2K realize there's not a whole lot left in the tank for Giants, and they're going to be able to turn right back around as Odawamne sniffing out to see if they can get a counter engage. Nothing doing.
And we need to track the ultimates that we used in that setup. Knight doesn't have his ultimate available. Hikyu used the curtain call. As Flaxish now getting locked up.
Every time I look at Flaxish, he's got the chains on him right now. And Febiven actually stays a little too long. He gets bopped with the barrel. Shay is going to get knocked into the team. Pinballed for a quick kill by Flaxish. And now Odawamne is going to flash, but he's caught. And let's see if he can get away from this one. He turns it right back around. But they get the big blowback. Knight's going to be taken low, but he's got a shield memento as well. This is a real bruiser of a fight right now. But if Febiven is looking to delete people, it's Jankos that finds one kill. Memento limps out alive. Knight is trying to pick one up. He gets one. Can he get another? Gets Nuclear, but it's Odawamne that gets the Guardian Angel, and now Hikyu's coming in. Odo knows he does not have enough damage left to make this happen. It's a 2-for-4, or 2-for-3, I should say.
Such an extended fight for both teams. I don't think either one of them really wanted to force that, but with Giants getting themselves such a big pick onto Che, they thought that they could try and get themselves a collapse. But then H2K respond in kind, both demonstrating that their teamfighting power is not to be underestimated.
Absolutely, and they're not going to walk away from that without getting anything else either. The Winians were marching in the bot, marching in the top, and before Giants can respond, they're going to be able to take down that tier 2, so Giants are going to have to work on those side lanes. Let's see this fight again, though.
But look at the positioning of Che. He realizes he's getting collapsed on by Knight. He feels that his only room of escape is to go up, so he ends up getting collapsed upon. And at this point, Giants feel strong enough to try and force the fight. But look at the positioning of Febiven, and look at the positioning of Nuclear. Both of the main damage dealers of H2K are just free to get all of this AoE damage off, whereas Hikyu and Knight are forced back into this choke point. The only person they can really hit are the tanks. So it becomes a losing fight initially for the side of Giants simply due to the geography of the map and the position the Giants were forced into. Fortunately, because they had already gotten that initial pick onto Che, they end up coming out head overall.
Still a very close gold game right now. Mere 500 separating the two teams as we crest the 30-minute mark, getting ourselves closer and closer to that late game. Nuclear on the Sivir is going to start to be a monster. But Febiven's LeBlanc, he definitely didn't get snowballed early, or snowballing early. Jankos, despite his efforts to make that happen, he himself got quite a lot of damage. Let's see if they can get some more out as Jankos gets a kickoff onto Hustlin, and they get a quick 2 deletion. They're looking for more. That shutdown. Nuclear getting some big gold and a double kill there. Looking for Flaxish, who finds himself without a whole lot of allies. Knight trying to get some pot shots in, but that's not happening. And H2K are eyeballing the Baron.
Exquisite engage coming out from H2K as they get a collapse down onto Giants as they look to set up around the Baron. Clean punish will result in H2K transitioning over to this big objective, and this should solidify them a very strong lead if they can secure it.
No smite contestability. It's 20 seconds before Memento comes back up, so H2K can play this one out. Knight's in controlled. Jankos gets the smite on, and Knight was going in to see if he could make a steal happen, but in the end, he just gives his life right over to Nuclear, and that's an ace right before Hustlin comes up.
What a great play from H2K, finding two members of Giants just ever so slightly out of position, and forcing them to get collapsed on by the entire lineup results in them quickly getting a Baron, and now they're already exerting pressure onto the base of Giants.
Yeah, they got plenty of damage to be able to take down one tower in the mid. They're going to rotate up towards the top side. Odawamne is already there, and he's just going to be able to tank this as he fires through the minion wave. It's saplings, everything. Flax is trying to push him back, but when the rest of H2K have arrived, there's little these guys can do. 5 seconds on Hikyu, respawn. Knight's still waiting for another 15 seconds. It looks like H2K are looking to close the curtains on this game. They're going to take their time about it, though. No need to push in when everybody's coming back up.
And now Giants just doing what they can to stymie all of the suffering that they've just endured. As you can see, the setup from H2K is very good because they know that all this vision is being cleared out. They don't realize that Jankos is coming from the top half of the river. A very good slow from Che enables Jankos to get a quick flash ulti in to knock the bottom lane or the Zyra out of position, and then they end up getting a clean collapse. Once both Memento and Huslin are taken out of the fight, there's nothing that Knight and Hiku can really do to turn things around in their favor. So just a really unfortunate setup for Giants. Like, their priority was just to get some vision, and they just didn't respect the possible collapse to come out from H2K.
You gotta be careful when you're that squishy, especially trying to get your dual laners that far out. So now H2K with Baron, with the towers knocked down in full control, will be able to get themselves an easy Mountain Drake. There's really not much Giants can do about this one. I mean, the comeback potential for this game seems quite difficult for them. They still got Ryze.
I mean, they still have good late game. Notice that we talked a little bit about the Jhin build earlier on. It does have more potent scaling than the Lethality build. But the problem is the lack of wave clear, right? Like, when you think about a Jhin, you don't think, oh, his wave clear is fantastic. Ryze is decent, but against Baron-empowered minions who have high magic resistance, things become very difficult for the side of Giants, and the ability to stop the push coming in from H2K.
Yeah, you can see it right there. Knight's having a little bit of a hard time finishing this one off. H2K playing this out 1-3-1, keeping Febivin close enough to be able to get involved if he wants to make the play, but they're looking for the base right now, and they can take their time about it. Baron still has about a minute left of efficiency or effectiveness. Oduwamne continually pushing in the top side is going to force Flax just responding to that time and time again. Little the Giants can do, but try to wait this one out. We'll see. It looks like there's some action heading up towards the top side. Nuclear stopped up for a second. They got the Stranglethorns. He flashes. He's got a shield, and they're teleporting up there. Let's see who's catching who. It's Che, who gets deleted by HQ, and now Giants might just have the chance to get the fight. Collateral damage. Knight, though, he's the one tanking all of it. Let's see if Oduwamne can finish the job here. The cleanse is on. He's slipping away, and H2K have backed off for the time being. It's a one-for-one trade, as Flax just had gone down in that fight, and a redemption's gonna come in to keep Nuclear and the rest of this team nice and healthy.
H2K still have a minion wave, they still have the Baron, and they're going for a die.
EQ nearly bought it on that one. It was Febivin going towards him, and it's going to be an easy inhibitor take. 34 and a half minutes in, H2K, they're not gonna take too many risks. Che might have gotten taken down, but they had enough power to be able to finish that tower off.
I really like the pick from Giants to try and catch H2K as they make that rotation up to the top lane, but they couldn't quite get enough kills. They couldn't get a proper engage to prevent H2K from breaking into the base. And so H2K are quickly able to turn things around, get themselves an inhibitor, even get a kill down onto Flaxish. And overall, they're happy with how the exchange went.
Yeah, this is the difference in the coordination between these two teams. You know, Giants, they had some great moves in the early game. They were playing well in the mid, but H2K is a team that can do this despite losing their support very early on. Nuclear also got taken quite low, but they had plenty of shields to work with.
H2K just wanted to force the fight to make it easier to get into the base of Giants. Giants did a good job of getting that initial pick and then just slowly kiting back. And you can just see that Nuclear took a little bit too much damage, which forced H2K to back away and not really be able to commit for the full-on 4v4 or 5v5. Nevertheless, they do get themselves an inhibitor, and now they can start playing the rest of the map, because you can just send, you can keep the LeBlanc in the mid lane, you can send the rest of your team down bottom. You still have Teleport on the Maokai, so you can even put him in mid or send the LeBlanc bottom. You have a lot of options, but basically all you want to do is wait for that top lane to push in and force Giants to split up, then use your numbers advantage to take the rest of the inhibitors.
And they've just got so fast pushing, so much Siege available to them. Even without the Baron buff, I mean, those late game Sivir is definitely able to shove mini waves like you wouldn't believe. Very slippery H2K team, too. See the QSS for Nuclear. Febivin with his teleport. The trick plays he's been pulling off this game around. It's been hard for Giants to get as many catches as they would like. And even though it looked really great for them to the start, I mean, 15 to 13 kills in favor of H2K, and it just shows you how this game has gone. Looking for the end game here. H2K, Flax is trying to make a desperate play. He catches Che for just a second, but Odo is dishing more damage than he is taking. Flaxish, I mean, curtain call not going to connect where he wants it. Notice just having a ball with the rest of this team. Jankos and Febivin will leisurely stroll up, and they don't even need to do anything.
Oduwamne takes absolutely zero damage off the back of that play. H2K can go back to splitting up, forcing Giant to wait from these towers, and they should be able to get themselves another one.
Easy peasy, they polish that one off, and Jankos flashes forward, doesn't actually connect with anything, but Knight is looking for a play right now himself. Stranglethorn's on a ton, but it's not going to knock anybody up. Redemption comes in a little bit later. Giants, Flaxish is going to get melted through by Nuclear. Memento trying for the collateral, but they're just too big, and Febivin finishes the job. Memento's gone down. There goes Hustlin. There goes Hikyu all the way back to Fountain the short way, and that is going to be the game with a triple kill and a swag Zhonyans for Febivin. 37 minutes in, H2K take the Nexus and take game one.
We certainly saw a few more kills in this game one than we did earlier on in the day. But it was rough starts for H2K. They definitely didn't quite get the snowball that they initially wanted. And nothing but praise for Memento and his ability to read Jankos and punish him. But it wasn't quite enough. H2K, they got a beautiful pick around the Baron. And that's really where things just opened up for H2K.
Yeah. For Giants, it's a little bit rough, but they got themselves an early game. They got most of a mid game. It's just not enough to take a game.
No, it was not. I felt as though they didn't properly push the advantages that they had. Like, they transitioned into the mid game still ahead. They had a very strong Graves. They had Arise, who was ahead of the LeBlanc. They didn't look to really force any of this. They were just kind of waiting around. They were letting H2K get picks around the map with the LeBlanc, punish the overextensions of Flaxish, look to get a lot of vision control around these objectives. And bear in mind, especially around the 20-minute mark, when we look at that Baron area, just remember how lit up it was for H2K when Giants were in the lead. Memento himself was the one that had the advantage, yet they weren't quite able to get the proper vision control around the objectives that they wanted to fight for.
I mean, that started the long trail of undoing for them. It's rough for Giants. I mean, they always seem to have a potential to take on almost any team, to be honest. I mean, this was a big underdog story for Giants. Had they been able to even take the one game, it would have been good for them. But as it stands, H2K still leading the series. Now, we're going to go ahead and send it over to the analyst desk to take a closer look at how game one panned out.
Thank you very much, Pyro. We're going to start by looking at the draft because, Sven, as I'm paraphrasing what you were talking about during the draft, it's not that you hate the Giants draft, but you think that they could have gotten more out of what they tried to build up with the...
Yeah, so Giants banned top laners, and then their answer to Maokai was a Gragas that was really useless. Gragas didn't do anything the entire game, and they could have picked it earlier and allowed themselves to pick support last and then have a better bot lane matchup because their bot lane got stomped. Well, not stomped, but they're 26 down, pushed the tower all game, and didn't really have any pressure at all. So they could, instead of banning Ashe, they could have banned Seaver, which would be a better ban in my opinion. They could also have picked support last, as I said earlier, and counterpick something better than blamping Syrah. And Gragas was not an ideal counterpick in my opinion. You should pick something like Illaoi or something else, since you banned Shen and Rumble, good picks against Maokai, right?
So. Yeah, a lot of investment and not right payoff for Giants.
Yeah, there's a lot of investment into getting very little value. Mm-hmm. Like, blind picking Zyra, getting Gragas against Maokai, like, you almost gain nothing from that, so that was a problem. I think also, like, what he's highlighting, an important thing about this patch right now is there's so many support options. So, actually, last picking support has a lot more value now because there is, like, a lot of different supports being picked against each other, like, small counters against each other. Zyra is still okay, but, like, doesn't have the same value she used to have. So that was obviously a problem for Giants, but I don't think the draft lost in the game. They were actually playing really well early game, especially Memento was being a guard on Graves, and we saw that first replay is him just going nuts in the mid lane after some pretty meh moments from H2K, like Febivan loses flash in a bad trade, and then Jankos completely misses Q right now, and then boom.
But it's worth mentioning how this kill happened twice in the series. He also got one more in the bot lane. Same thing happened. They wanted to kill Giants Knight, and they got counter ganked and double kill again, but Giants never found any leads out of this. They just got 1,000 gold, I mean, the four on Graves, and nothing happened.
Well, they did do something. They dove bottom lane, at least, as you see them discussing there. So it wasn't all bad for them, and it goes bad a bit after that. We are going to look at the right decision that they made here. They all dive bottom. As you said, they were getting behind, so they had to do something.
I think the dive is good, but it comes mainly from Jankos being topside in a tank versus tank matchup. And they saw him top, so they said, okay, let's go bot, take a blast cone. Ryze has pushed mid first, walks bot with the blast cone with two of the Graves, dive down 1-0. Flaxish hears this, he cancels the TP of Odoamne. Good dive, but the dive doesn't give a tower, just two kills, and then HK is the better team, better macro, so they swap top, get a tower for tower.
Yep.
When you're behind, trades are good. First tower for one tower and Ocean Drake is fine if you're behind. So Giants should have seen this one coming and maybe reacted better. Put Graves top with Gragas wave clear or something, right? But HK is just a better macro team in this situation.
I just feel like this is what we see in Europe all the time between top teams versus bottom teams. The bottom teams will have one or two like good moves like this one, which technically was like a good dive they set up. Mento was super fed. Again, as you said later, he got two more kills. He was 5-1 on the Graves. But then the superior team, in this case H2K, they ended up just always trading. They were dead even in gold. And it was like, okay, now it comes down to team fighting. And then we thought maybe here Giants might have a chance, but the problem is you're against Sivir as well, you're against Maokai. Like H2K's team fighting combos is like pretty bonkers. And we get to see like this first team fight they have, which is technically even, but then sadly right after for Giants, everything goes wrong. Like this is a team by the Giants is slightly winning.
Yeah, the fight starts 4-5-4 for Giants, and then Lorenzo goes to the choke point against LeBlanc, against Maokai, Lee Sin, Sivir. Like here, Giants could get aced anytime. By Sivir bounces, the kick, Fibriven could have made a better combo, maybe could have killed everyone here. Like look at the HP bars, Memento, and yeah. I think this fight could have been easily 5-0 for H2K. A different day, different game, to have won and kill everyone here, but...
But I right think, now it's even.
Like, yeah.
It's
like
even.
Giants came out on the top in the team fights, but then they get caught like this. Memento uses his E to kill a ward with no flash. Hustling Beast is also caught, gets killed, and it shows how Giants had chance in team fights and like in the early game stage of the game. Mm-hmm. But once it came to the macro part, where you get caught out in river like this, lose.
It's just one of those problems again for Giants, where it's like you didn't push out mid first, so you weren't the ones moving from mid to river, which basically means H2K could just run from mid, collapse. You saw Maokai move around, flank, and yeah, use your dash, you know, easy kills, and then H2K won this game, not by being like superior team fighters or play a better early game, but Giants has made some really key mistakes in terms of pure macro. H2K just instant punishes and wins. Like it's just, yeah.
And that is so frustrating, and it's exactly what we saw when Vitality was playing Misfits as well. What do you do as a team? Because we can come out here and say, well, you should crush the early game. They did, but you just can't make up those tools, the macro. That's something that comes after a really long time, and that makes it kind of a very difficult position going into game two for Giants. They are on blue side, though.
Also, you saw that Odam was 2-0, 15 Maokai, 85% kill participation. If you, again, ban out top laners like Shen and Rumble that do well against Maokai, then you need to have a better answer for Maokai than Gragas top, who went 1-7, didn't 0 E-flashes, 0 ults, he didn't do anything all game except for just dying. You need to have a better answer for Maokai than this if that's your draft plan. Like maybe a cheese pick like Illaoi, we've seen it before. Maybe some other like sort of counter pick, but Gragas top didn't do it this game. Maokai was just double tank of Gragas. And well, double teamfight power and everything better. So
they are on blue side, so we'll see if Giants decide to go for something else in the next game. But we are going to hide on bush. But when we come back, we'll be ganking game two between Giants and H2K. Don't go anywhere. It'll mess with my KDA.